by accident you would be infected. That's one. Number two, this attaches a social stigma to the patient, that you get the test done, then you condemn that patient to a corner. That, okay, you are HIV positive, won't touch you. So it's not acceptable. The only time you do these tests is when you have a needle stick injury, you want to establish the status. Roel, this, you decide whether they're going to stay here or they're going to go.
So, mic is not working.
So, just come and say that instead of talking to each other. Is it not working?
Yes, it's not.
We're sorry, just fixing it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So universal precautions.
Come on.
So universal precautions would be taken universally in all the cases. What are these precautions? Putting on a headgear, which is in the form of a cap. Two, or double caps. So some people, especially ladies, may need to put on a bigger cap to take care of the hair. They shouldn't be around, floating around. Two, putting on a visor in front, or putting glasses in front. Some of you can wear the glasses as shown here, which I'm going to wear throughout the day. Now these glasses are protective, disposable, they're used only once. Third, you have to put in a plastic sheet in front, which protects your body from getting any secretions or anything, blood, body fluids getting onto your clothes that you're wearing in the theater. Putting on the shoe wear, which is covering up your foot and the ankle. And in special cases, you will have the gum boots if you're dealing in specialties like, say, ops and gynae, urology, where there's lots of body fluids that float around. In addition to this, rest remains. That is putting on double gloves. The needle stick injuries incidence reduce strikingly if you put on double gloves rather than one glove. Thirdly, you should be taking care, which is more important. There is a box here. I think you can see it, or you can see on the in the camera if you focus this. The sharp disposal box, which has been kept in some of these stations. This is to just test your skills at disposing the sharps. Sharps should not be handled by two people. There should be no hand-to-hand exchange. No two hands should exchange sharps. And don't think needle stick injuries happen only to your enemies. They happen to your friends, and they happen to you. And even to your enemies, they shouldn't happen. You should not cause them to the other person. So if you're conscious of these injuries, you'll first of all prevent them in yourself and in also in your colleagues. Is that clear? The third thing is, when you're throwing something, whether it is body fluid or sharps, there's a place for it. You just can't throw wherever you like. Is that clear? Say a yes or no.
Yes, sir.
A louder yes.
Yes, sir.
That's better. So you wake up and we get on with it. So that's about the theater etiquette. The first part, since we've lost a little time, would be the instruments. There are certain plastic aprons which are available that you can see. One I'm opening up for you, and I'll show you how do you put on gloves. Now this plastic apron is disposable and a cheap one, and it protects your body from getting the secretions getting into your system. Let me just make it. So what you do is you fix it in front, then you put it on, and then they tie it at the back, so you're all covered. And I'm going to sit like this the whole day. You'll get one when you get on with bowel, etc. So that's about the theater etiquette. So now we move on to putting on gloves. There are two methods of putting on gloves. One is a closed method, the other is an open method. You need to know one. The closed method used to be where somebody will help you put on the gloves. I'm making something out of it, so bear with me. When you open up the packet, the gloves would be lying like this, and you're learning the open method. And you have to do it yourself, this is how you do it. And it is like this that it would be lying. Now, can you do something to this camera, because I won't be able to see. That's okay, now I can see. That's okay. Now, this is a glove that we have opened up. You won't see it, I'm sure you have. Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Good. Now, what do I do is what you have learned already. So, I'm just reinforcing the thought. Remember, after I washed my upper limbs, right up to the mid of the arm. People say elbow, I would say mid of the arm, because if you clean up the middle of the arm, your hands, your arms automatically go up. So you try to have the fluid dripping the other way. It shouldn't drip this way. That would be wrong. So with the hands down and walking like a soldier would be wrong. With the hands up and praying like you do it in a mosque is the right way to do it. Probably that's why probably it's done also. You wash up and you go like this. My approach would be now to understand that there is a part of the glove which is the inner lining, and a part of the glove which is the outer cover. My body can touch the inner lining, not the outer cover, that's it. But once I have the glove on, it can touch the outer cover. Now, depending upon whether I prefer to put the left first, since I'm right-handed, so I'll hold the glove like this. Maybe you can go a little further to get a good picture, that it's visible, yes. Now, I will then slide in my thumb into the thumb space, and this is called thumb into the thumb technique. And you keep holding to the inner side, you can understand this is not the routine glove, but I'm holding on to the inner side, which is the key. And as I pull it, I leave it there, and I don't go beyond it. Now, I hold on to the inner side with my right hand now, and I can now use my left hand, which is gloved, to touch the outer cover, which is not a problem. And this becomes a relatively easier job to do. So even in your sleep, you should, like I'm deliberately keeping it like this so that you can understand. I can use my gloved hand to take care of this and have it nicely, snugly fitting. And then there is a ring that can go on top of whatever I'm wearing. It's a gown that it goes on top of this, okay? So, by and large, this was the way to put on a glove. The closed method is where a nurse, scrub nurse, puts on a glove herself and then she slides it into your hands. But actually, you need two people to do that. You should learn to do alone. That's a luxury, you won't get it. Let's move to the next step. Any doubts here? I've gone through the theater etiquette. So, first exercise was mainly theoretical. But please understand universal precautions and keep them in the back of your mind all the time. Do not play with sharps. Never handle sharps anywhere. In the old Ethicon Institute, where we had got a small little, I used to do the skill courses there. There's a small circle and we have shown a knife and we put a cross. No two hands should touch the sharps. And if I have to receive knife in my theater from the scrub nurse, she will have to give it in a kidney tray. I'll put it in the kidney tray. So it goes around this way. Be careful with the blades, needles in the theater. I can't emphasize it further. It's so important. You should understand. Now let's move to the instruments and we'll take one exercise at a time. The first exercise is to get hold of all the instruments, and as I take them, I will teach you. Touch nothing. Just write if you want to in a small pad. But touch no instrument. It is distracting and you'll also unnecessarily attract others' attention. The first instrument that we identify a surgeon with is a knife. And this is not a knife. This is a handle of a knife. It's called Bart Parker handle. What? Louder? B-A-L-D, that is Bald. Parker. It's a company. Before this, it used to be a fixed assembly. The blade and the handle were one. Now they're detachable. The advantage with that is, you don't have to throw each time. Otherwise you have to throw. Even now you get disposable blades, knives, which are disposable. You throw them away. That's expensive. So you have the handle fixed, and the blades can be disposable, like we have here. Okay? Now look at the handle carefully. Can you concentrate here, please? Just look here, don't look anywhere else. You see, this has got a shaft which has got fenestrations. Are they visible from where you are? Please let me know, because I won't be able to see very clearly. If there is anything which is not visible, do let me know. These are the fenestrations. Any instrument, if you find fenestrations, remember that's the place to hold it. If you hold it anywhere else, it's an aberration, not acceptable. You getting my point? The modifications would happen if you're making knife do something different. Can you just bolt it?
Yes, sir.
Now, this has... It's disturbed. Now that these are the fenestrations which are for the grip. There's a slot here for the blade to sit. And you can see that the other side doesn't have this slot. So the first exercise that we're going to do today, which is also marked, and I'll request the faculty after we've done it to mark it, is to load the blade on the handle. You would think that this is something very, very simple. It indeed is. But simple things are because of most of the major problems in the world. So learn the right way of doing it. And most of the time we leave it to the nurse to do it. She, if she knows it, she will do it correctly, otherwise there will be a problem. Now, how do you get the blade out of the wrapper? Before these disposable blades came into use, one used to palpate to find which end is sharp and avoid the sharp end. But now we have, fortunately, this opening only on one side, which is the rear end. Once you find which end to open up, it opens up like a wrapper. There you are. This is the rear end of the blade. And I'll use an instrument to bring it out. You get it? And we are not in an alignment here. So I won't use my hand now. That's what I, typically for this reason I have shown you this reverse grip. So you will hold with the forceps, go around, then I have an option to go this way or this way. I'll go this way because the sharp end is away from where the instrument is. And lock it completely so that it's steady now. It doesn't go anywhere. And what do I do next? I'll just slide in. That's not a problem, you all know. Sits in with a click. Right? And how do I take it off, which is a part two? Hold the rear end, give it a gentle thrust and leave it there. Don't take it out, because it'll fly around. Get it close to where you need it. Say in this case, I have a sharp disposal box. I'll hold the front and I'll throw it, so that it doesn't start flying around. What are UFOs? Louder. And IFOs? Identified flying object. This will be an IFO if you just let it float, and it happens. So be careful. Do not let it fly where you don't want it to go. It should always be within your reach and you should be able to sight it. The blade is ready. And the next exercise is to make an incision. Remember, you do not give an incision. There is nothing like giving an incision. The state, the word, the expression used is making an incision. And how do you make an incision? I'll just quickly show you, and then we'll move on to the other instruments. Can you zoom here, please? Now that is supposedly, I mean, this is the skin. And remember, we have to make an incision. A blade cuts from your left to your right, or from a point away from you to a point towards you. And scissors is just the opposite. Clear? Now there are various grips to the knife. One is the classical grip, which you will watch here, also called as palm grip. and the other is a paint brush grip, which is when you're using blade for something else. When you're making an incision, the classical grip is louder, louder, palm grip. What is palm grip? I'll hold the fenestration between my middle finger and the thumb and use my index finger to let it sit on the knife, on the blade, sorry, and this would disappear in my palm, which is the sharpest part of the blade. Hello? Which would be the sharpest part of the blade?
Tip.
Tip. How many for tip? Raise your hand. No, no, raise your hand. Nobody's going to chop them off. Don't worry. Tip. How many for the remaining blade? Well, you have to be for one of these, no? What is that remaining blade? Well, the sharpest part of the blade is the belly and partly the curvatures, right? But this is the belly, right? And the idea of making an incision is to put the belly on the skin. Tip is not, repeat, not the sharpest part. But tip can be used for various functions. You can ask the question, why have a tip? The problem is you cannot have the belly unless you have the head. So you have to have the tip also. And tip is used for identifying where the belly is, and there is a portion of the belly which will be used for making an incision, and the portion between the tip and the belly is used for raising a flap. So there are two functions to the knife. One is making an incision, two, raising a flap. Both. Raising a flap means dissection. Is that alright? Yes or no? You must keep saying yes loudly because I'm looking here, so that if there is any doubt, I'll repeat, especially the students in the last row. Now, how do I make an incision? I have the skin spread between my index finger and the thumb, the left hand, and I'm making an incision from left to right. So what do I do? I'll spread it like this. He's adjusting, good, thank you. Now, my hand would cover it. Correct, thank you. The left hand to spread the skin. Clear? And I start from a point A. I keep going with the same pressure throughout, and when I reach the other end, I do a little bit of palm flexion. This palm flexion allows that the incision doesn't tail off. The depth is the same. You can never have the same depth at both the corners, but it should be as close to being the same depth as possible. Because eventually you can't have it vertical also because you can't close it there. So it must be a little slant on both sides, but it should be more or less equal. And you can see that's the incision. Yes, to up, you will see as I see. Now, there will be no block because you will do as I do. This is the incision. We have made an incision now. You will all make it. I am just completing the instruments, then you will make the incision and we will also put a suture. Now, once I have finished with the job, I have made the incision, I can show you how do we use it to raise the flap. Now watch it. This is the grip, which is the second grip I was talking about. This is paint brush grip. What does it do? I'm not going to use the tip. I'm not going to use the belly. So what I'm going to use is, I've lifted up the flap, the skin, and I'll use the portion between the, if you can watch it carefully, between the tip and the belly. And I can just gently keep cutting, and it will be a flap that I can raise of uniform thickness throughout. I can go in the reverse manner the same way. So I'm using the portion between the tip and the belly. So now you know why tip is needed, and we have raised the flap. Now once you raise the flap with the blade, you realize that it's superior to any other instrument in raising a flap. Now, since we are cutting, we move on to the next cutting instrument, which is scissors. Any doubts about putting the blade on the handle and taking it off? Yes or no?
Yes,
sir. So our first exercise is, please put the blade on the handle and put it down and make an incision. That you will get 6 minutes to do it. There are two people on each station, so share the work. Make two incisions. Right? The time starts now and the faculty would watch you and they will mark you for what you do. And we'll get back to scissors. No talking, please.